Good morning.
Good morning.
It's my pleasure this morning to welcome you to Georgetown Presbyterian Church. We gather here as the people of God to celebrate the goodness and the mercy and the blessings of God in our lives and to share that special sense of community together that is called church. So we're delighted that you're here this morning. If you're visiting with us, we welcome you most cordially, and we pray that you will receive a blessing from being here, and it is certainly true that you bless us by being here. So thank you for being here. Please, if you will, take a moment to fill out the pad that you'll find on the end of the pew. If you would pass that down to the end and then back, then we would be most grateful for that. Corey is not here this morning. He and Nancy are in Athens, Georgia, feeling very happy today that the Georgia Bulldogs beat Notre Dame. So they are feeling very, very happy, I'm sure, about that. Several announcements I need to call your attention to. Next Sunday is going to be a little unusual Sunday because we don't generally have more than one focus on a Sunday, but it just happened that way this time. So there are two major mission functions next week. Normally on the last Sunday of the month, you know, we take up food for Helping Hands. But twice a year, we put a special emphasis upon the food. We usually try to pick, the committee does, two times a year when the need is the most acute. And so next Sunday, we will be receiving an expanded gift of food for Helping Hands. This is a very small bag, which is given to me simply as a reminder not to forget to mention it. But the children have made bags, and they have decorated them. And we hope that when you go out this morning that you will take one of those bags and that you will fill that bag up with food and that you will bring it back, not non-perishable food, that you will bring it back next Sunday and that we will have a great in-gathering of food. This is such an important ministry that our church engages in. Last time we had the special emphasis, we took up brought in 144 bags of food. And the people at Helping Hands told us what a difference that made for their ministry and all of our ministry together. So next Sunday, please get a bag as you leave today and bring your bags back, and you can bring them here to the front or you can set them on the aisle, and we will receive the food offering for Helping Hands. The second thing is that all year long, I'm sure you have been doing this, we have these little straw baskets that we put change for children. And the change that we have goes to orphanages in Zambia to help children who have been orphaned because of the HIV crisis. And so next Sunday we will be gathering that offering. If you don't have a basket yet, if you'll see Ann Martin, she will make sure that you get a basket. And if you haven't been saving change all year, you can put a check in there or put cash in there or whatever. But next Sunday we will be gathering the offering for Change for Children and for the orphanages in Zambia. And our mission committee, because of the importance of this offering, has taken from their budget $3,000 as matching funds. So they will match every dollar you give up to $3,000. So next Sunday is going to be a great mission Sunday at Georgetown Presbyterian Church, and I know it's something that we will all celebrate together. Also, at the end of the worship service next week, we're going to have a special business meeting to elect our elders and our trustees for the next term. Thank you again for being here today. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And Bruce asked me, and I almost forgot, to announce that the youth will not meet tonight. They just had a lock-in, and they're worn out.
Answered me and have become my salvation.
The stone the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Come to us this morning with power of a great wind to clear out the cobwebs of our hearts or to come stealthily as close as our own breathing. We ask you to whisper your truth into the silence of our lives. O God, however you may come this morning, come with the power to change us that we might truly become the body of Christ in your world. Amen. Now confess our sins before God and one another, together and then in silence. Creator of the universe, victim of our sins, breath of life. We come trembling before you, for we have ordered and guarded what has been ours in the hope of securing our future. We have yearned for wealth more than we have yearned for you. We have squandered your trust and grieved your heart with our betrayal. Help us, O God of our salvation, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and forgive our sins for your name's sake. Our loving God desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Hear this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
us bow our heads and pray.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory.
God's people say. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Listen now to these words. For everything there is a season, and every time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
gospel lesson this morning is taken from the sixth chapter of the gospel according to Matthew. We'll recognize this, of course, as part of the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus had gathered before his disciples and the crowds that had come with them. We begin reading with verse 25 of the sixth chapter. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into the barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, why will he not more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all of these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For everything, there's a season. A season, a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. Thus, the wisdom writer reminds us of the reality of the seasons of life, filled with rich transitions, transitions of laughter and tears, of gathering and loosing, and ultimately with finiteness. The biblical faith sees all of these as a gift. The seasons of our lives are not something that haphazardly occurs. The seasons of our lives are a gift from God. They are part of God's creation, held together in his providence, and lived out in what we call time. Since I was a child, I've always been fascinated by hourglasses. Hourglasses, you know, that the two globes on each side and a little thin, narrow connecting tube in between, and they're filled with very fine sand. And with these, if you turn them the full side up and the empty side down, you can see the sand sifting through from top to bottom. Now, people use these as timers to cook eggs or timers for other things, but I think it's also symbolic of life. Life is that which begins and then little by little sifts through. And one day we're living our lives and suddenly we come to the realization that there's more in the bottom than there is in the top. And sometimes this causes us to panic, to get all worked up about ourselves and wondering what is going to happen. We get to thinking about what we have and what we don't have, and what we need and what we don't need, and what is the meaning of our lives, and what is the purpose of all of this. And we begin to get into very weighty and heavy things, and sometimes people get very afraid and they begin to worry. To worry and worry and worry about life and about death. I've really been reflecting on this whole concept of the seasons of life recently, especially this past week when I thankfully had another birthday. And it was even more sobering when I read this from the Psalms. The days of our lives are 70 years, or perhaps 80 if we're strong. And I realized that I'm operating on bonus time. But I will try to stay strong. I was talking with Beverly Freeman a while back, who is the chairperson of the Committee on Administration for the session, and I told her that I would probably be looking toward retirement sometime next year. She asked me an interesting question. Bill, what are you going to do when you retire? Well, I answered more quickly than I should have, and I said, well, one thing's for sure, I'm not going to do anything for the first 6 months. But you know, that question has stayed with me over the last few months, and it has kind of had become a focus of really looking at who I am and what I am. And what I would say to that to answer that question now is I would hope that the rest of my life would be informed by the scripture that I read this morning from the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus' message to his disciples, especially from our gospel lesson today. The passage has been often called one of the most beloved statements of trust and love and care in the entire scripture. Jesus, of course, was speaking, as I said, to his disciples. Disciples who had suddenly, and this was early in the ministry, who had suddenly left their fishing nets and left their vocations and left their tasks to follow Jesus. Now, I'm sure they got some feedback from home about changing their life vocation or changing the direction of their lives. And they may even have wondered something themselves at times. What are we going to do? What are we going to wear? How are we going to survive? How are we going to provide for ourselves and our families? How are we going to look to the future? And yet Jesus was trying to give them some words of assurance. Words of assurance that says that they can trust in him as they walk in fellowship with him and as they serve him and as they walk together, that there can be the fulfillment not only of the work that he has called them to do, but the fulfillment of the deepest needs and the deepest longings of their lives. As they went about doing, they would also go about finding purpose and direction and hope and meaning. That didn't mean that they did not have any challenges, that they did not face threats, that they did not encounter difficulties and conflict, but it meant that over the whole spectrum of life itself, that God was with them, that underneath were the everlasting arms, and in that, they could find peace. Same promise he makes to us. A promise that whatever the time is in our lives, whether we're young or whether we're old, it is a promise that Jesus has for us with every season of life. And it is an invitation to let our times become his time and for us to rejoice in the times that he shares with us and brings to us. Now, this isn't a call to just put everything in neutral and say, well, I don't have to do any more work and I don't have to worry about anything because the Lord's just going to take care of me. I don't think that's at all what Jesus was trying to say, that he calls us to be responsible. He calls us to live with a sense of purpose and not a sense of entitlement, but to find in our lives that kind of harmony in living in contact, in the context of His will and His way, in which we can find meaning and blessing and satisfaction. That the deepest longings of our lives can be filled through Him and with Him. I think that the writer of Proverbs offers some very wise advice. He says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths." It's a call to take Him seriously, to take seriously His call and His will. And if we follow Jesus, He will lead us. He will provide for us the resources and the insights which we need for living our lives. So often it becomes very easy for us to want to tell God what He needs to do rather than listening to what God calls us to do. To say, I've got a little cartoon in my office that sits on my desk that says something to the effect, "Well, I always intended to serve God, but I wanted to do it in the comfort of my own surroundings and my own home." That isn't all the way it works. It works. Sometimes God calls us out of our comfort zones, and it's important for us to listen and hear and respond, because it is in so hearing and so doing that we find life's deepest meaning. I very deeply believe, very sincerely believe, that God will lead us and bring meaning to our time. That's been my experience over my life. When I was a college student, 62 years ago, two little churches on the South Carolina, Georgia line. I was Baptist, so you could do that when you're Baptist. 62 years ago, two little churches on the South Carolina, Georgia line, two big churches. One had almost 50 members. The other had 18 members. And they had were accustomed to having Furman students. And so one day I was preaching in McCormick, South Carolina, at the First Baptist Church for the pastor who was ill. And I saw these people out there that one of them I knew because he sold meal to my father's grocery store. And so they asked me if they could speak to me after church, and they said that they would like for me to come and talk to them about being their pastor. Me being your pastor? I did not know anything about being a pastor. I'd preached maybe a half a dozen sermons, but they asked me if I would come and be their pastor. And what I discovered, that God was opening a precious opportunity for me to grow and to learn and to be. Those folks in Parksville and Modoc, South Carolina, loved me and supported me and taught me how to be a pastor. The 4.5 years that I served there were years that helped me to grow and helped me to be. And they were fulfilling. I could have very easily said, "Not me, Lord. I've got a lot to do in college. I'm going to have me a big..." And I did have some fun in college. But it was an example of how God often leads. 13 years ago, almost now, Linda and I had closed our store, and this is something I'm not supposed to ever mention. We had closed our store in Litchfield, and we were members of this church, and I got a phone call from Steve Wilkins, and Steve said, "Bill, Would you be interested in coming on for a few hours a week and doing some pastoral care for our church? I was surprised. You know, Steve was very Presbyterian, and I had all of my ministry had been in Baptist churches. My theological training had been in Baptist institutions, and so I was kind of surprised. But I prayed about it and I thought about it, and you know what? The door opened for one of the richest experiences. You richly blessed me. And I know that that was what God was leading me to do and to be. And we're not quite finished yet. To go back to the question that Beverly Freeman raised for me, what am I going to do when I retire? I don't know, but I believe God knows, and I hope that I will have the patience and the wisdom and the insight to listen. I believe that our times belong to God, and if we listen, He will lead us, and we, as we encounter Him, we will find deep meaning for our lives. And time that sometimes creates fear for us can be our friend. Time, you see, is the place where we can celebrate the words of the psalmist. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Peggy Clary reminded me that we did have to sing one Baptist song. We are people richly blessed by God who loves us and sustains us. One of the ways we show our gratitude is by the gifts we give and by the lives we serve. And so now, remembering God's grace and mercy, let us bring our tithes and offerings. Thank you. Let us pray. O Lord, receive the gifts that we bring and every expression of praise and love and thanksgiving that we offer to you. Thank you for letting us be your people and binding us together in this blessed fellowship. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us now express and confess what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed that are printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. May we again pray together. O Lord, we give you thanks that you are good and that your steadfast love endures forever. We pray that our lives, as well as our words, may say over and over and proclaim to all who will hear, your steadfast love endures forever. We confess you this day, and we thank you for the love that you have extended to us in Jesus, your only Son, whom you gave that our sins might be forgiven and that we might have life. We pray this morning, compassionate God, for one another. Only you know the cares and concerns that rest in each of our hearts. But because you know us, we have the assurance that all of these concerns are taken seriously and that you embrace each of us with the love and healing power of your grace. We pray also for our community, for those who don't have enough food or inadequate shelter or lack security or lack medical care that they need for a meaningful life. We're grateful for all of the faithful servants in this church and in this community who continuously reach out with care and assist the needy and the oppressed. May we all, O Lord, be moved to embrace our world and its people with the kind of love and compassion that you've given to us. May we listen to your word and grasp your will, that we may be your faithful servants in all things and in all times. We celebrate today and the time that you give to us. Through your Holy Spirit, enable us to discover all the love and joy and fullness that you wish for us. Bless us and empower us to be a blessing. We pray in Jesus' name, and we pray the prayer that he taught us to say, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.